So as we've been talking about this summer series from 1 and 2 Samuel, we've talked about how expansive this story is. Once again, I would encourage you to pick up your Bibles. I know you have them. Dust them off and turn to 1 Samuel to get the whole of this story that isn't captured by these Sunday readings. But as a kind of an example of how expansive this story is, it so happens that this Sunday, the cycle of readings actually gives us a choice between two sections of 1 Samuel. The first story is the story of David facing down the Philistine army and its giant, Goliath. Even people who don't know anything about the Bible have some understanding of this story. It's become the ultimate cultural or sports cliche for describing a contest between a bigger, stronger, richer team or competitor and one who seemingly has no chance against them. They're seen as smaller, weaker, less well-resourced. Popular writer and journalist Malcolm Gladwell even wrote a book about this dynamic, subtitling it Underdogs, Misfits, and the Art of Battling Giants. The second option is the one we're going to hear. This is coming from 1 Samuel, beginning at the end of chapter 17, verse 57. And I know that your worship order says that we're going to skip verses 6 through 9, which is stupid, so we're not going to skip them. We're going to read the whole thing to chapter 18, verse 16. Listen for God's word to you this morning. On David's return from killing the Philistine, Abner took him and brought him before Saul with the head of the Philistine in his hand. Saul said to him, "Whose son are you, young man?" And David answered, "I am the son of your servant Jesse, the Bethlehemite." When David had finished speaking to Saul, the soul of Jonathan was bound to the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul. Saul took him that day and would not let him return to his father's house. Then Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved him as his own soul. Jonathan stripped himself of the robe that he was wearing and gave it to David and his armor and even his sword and his bow and his belt. David went out and was successful wherever Saul sent him. As a result, Saul set him over the army, and all the people, even the servants of Saul, approved. As they were coming home, when David returned from killing the Philistine, the women came out of all the towns of Israel, singing and dancing to meet King Saul with tambourines and songs of joy and with musical instruments. And the women sang to one another as they made merry, "Saul has killed thousands, and David." Saul was very angry, for this saying displeased him. He said, "They have ascribed to David 10,000s, and to me they have ascribed thousands. What more can he have but the kingdom?" So Saul eyed David from that day. The next day, an evil spirit from God rushed upon Saul, and he raved within his house while David was playing the lyre, as he did day by day. Saul had his spear in his hand, and Saul threw the spear, for he thought, "I will pin David to the wall." But David eluded him twice. Saul was afraid of David, because the Lord was with him, but had departed from Saul. So Saul removed him from his presence and made him a commander of 1,000. And David marched out and came in, leading the army. David had success in all his undertakings, for the Lord was with him. When Saul saw that he had great success, he stood in awe of him. But all Israel and Judah loved David, for it was he who marched out and came in, leading them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You can kind of see how it probably would have been easier to talk about David and Goliath than to examine the next part. But that's precisely why we chose to hear this story instead. What makes this a difficult text to examine is that it raises a question that has been a hot topic of scholarly debate for at least the past half century. Namely, what does it mean that the soul of Jonathan was bound to the soul of David, and that Jonathan loved him as his own soul? Much ink has been spilled making the case that this language suggests a bond between David and Jonathan that is more than simple friendship, but rather romantic or even illicit. And just as much ink has been spilled refuting such suggestions, which raises the issue of how we bring to the Bible whole sets of assumptions and expectations that are conditioned by far more than what's in the text itself, because often the text is ambiguous and lends itself to multiple readings. If we're someone who is made uncomfortable by homosexuality, then our negative assumption will argue for the bond between these two men to be close, perhaps, but certainly not sexual. Likewise, if we're someone who is hoping to find some biblical support or affirmation for gay relationships, then this language might sound like music to our ears. Meanwhile, I think there is more to this whole passage than simply the relationship between Jonathan and David, but something having to do with how the purposes of God are both advanced and thwarted by something that has less to do with human sexuality and more to do with... Let's back up a little. In the early morning hours of June 28th, 1969, New York City police raided the Stonewall Inn, a gay club in Greenwich Village. That raid was the catalyst for a six-day uprising as bar patrons and neighborhood residents clashed with police over the ongoing harassment they experienced for just holding hands, or kissing, or simply dancing with someone of the same sex. 30 years later, in recognition of the gains made for gay rights since the Stonewall Uprising, the month of June was designated as Gay Pride Month. Now, many people mistake pride for some attempt to advance this nefarious agenda, when in truth, pride is about so much more than sexuality. It's about identity. It's about being seen for who a person is without the kind of shame and derision that might otherwise drive them to hide their light under a bushel basket. Or worse, end their life altogether. But here's the thing. Pride isn't just for the LGBT community. Because when homosexuality is stigmatized, It isn't just gay people who suffer. Which brings me back to David and Jonathan and how we understand the love that they have for one another. Multiple studies now have documented what has come to be called an epidemic of male loneliness or friend recession. In essence, what it describes is the growing inability of men to form the kinds of deep friendships that everyone needs in order to navigate the ups and downs of life. And much of that has to do with the fear that deeper expressions of the human experience, like joy or delight, sensitivity, vulnerability, or sadness, might make someone less of a man, a pansy, gay. You hear it, right? There's a heavy dose of misogyny in there as well. And these cultural messages that surround us can cause us to shut down whole parts of ourselves for fear. They can also cut us off from the very love God commands us to have for one another. A love, I would argue, God commands because it is essential to our well-being. When we are more fearful of how we are perceived than we are of our own isolation and loneliness, when we are more adamant in defending a relationship between Jonathan and David as definitely not gay, then we are in learning what it might mean to have our soul bound to another so that we love that one as we do our own soul. We not only miss the plot, we do damage to ourselves and to the text. And if we want to see what isolation and loneliness do to a person, we don't have to look any further than this text, because it's right there in the actions and behaviors of Saul. In the story that we didn't hear, when David steps up to fight the Philistine champion Goliath, Saul attempts to arm him as he would himself, with a bronze helmet, a coat of mail, and a large sword. And it's got to be one of the more comedic moments in that story, because David simply cannot walk with all that armor. He cannot move in Saul's world as Saul does. He cannot be the warrior that Saul thinks he should be. None of it fits. David cannot be Saul. David will not be Saul. To expect someone to move through the world dressed up as something they're not, in the armor that we think they should wear, maybe even because we're trying to protect them from the danger we see, only serves to immobilize them under the weight of all that expectation. And when David is able to slay the giant without any of that, when he's able to fell the Philistine champion with a sling and 5 smooth stones because God is with him, and bring the head of Goliath to Jerusalem for the king to see, Saul recognizes he's something special. Takes him into his house. But no sooner is David in his house than Saul turns on him. Saul could see. Well, we already know what we learned last week in Samuel's visit to the house of Jesse. God has rejected Saul as king. And David has found favor in God's eyes. Now, I think it would be a mistake to say that at this point Saul is doomed because God has already somehow ordained it. Rather, I think it seems that Saul has already demonstrated a willingness to take shortcuts, with a half-hearted obedience that is undermined by the selfish ambition of someone trying to hold on to power at any cost. Saul's actions only demonstrate what God had already seen in him. Meanwhile, David is the opposite. He takes any role that he is given, regardless of its status. He serves as the bearer of Saul's armor, an armor that doesn't even fit him. He plays the lyre for Saul, who wants to kill him. David receives Jonathan's love, and with it his robe, and his armor, his sword, and his bow and belt. But David is not clothed for battle. He's clothed by this gesture with Jonathan's love and devotion. The more love that David receives from Jonathan, from the women who sing his praises as he comes through town, from all of Israel and Judah, the angrier Saul becomes. And the angrier Saul becomes, the more he isolates himself from the very love that would save him. It's a vicious cycle of self-sabotage that will lead to his downfall, because in the petulance of his toxic rage and isolation, Saul also cuts himself off from the life-giving love of God. We don't need to know the intimate details of David and Jonathan's love to see how Saul's jealousy, fear, and deep insecurity in response to their love contributes to his own undoing. It's what contributes to the undoing of any who would meet such expressions of love in the same way. Love is love. Is love. Is love. Is love. To distance ourselves or cut ourselves off from that is to distance and cut ourselves off from the source of life. The one who is with David, the one who is with us in all of our going out and coming in times of uncertainty and danger, just as we are. And nothing less. Alleluia. Amen. Would you stand as we say what we believe using the words from the letter to the church in Rome printed in your worship order? We believe there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For we know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to God's purpose. We are convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.